Welcome to our India's Knowledge Series video number 32. Today we start the Ind AS 109 financial instruments. This standard, as we have discussed earlier, being a very big standard or voluminous standard, what I felt is that I will split the standards in 1 hour slot each so as to ensure that you will be able to have proper time for revision as well as to understand the concepts properly. And accordingly, today we will be discussing the part relating to recognition of financial instruments, the measurement principles relating to financial instruments, the various classifications based on which the measurements is going to be accounted for. That will be the first part of our discussion. The second part, we will have a reclassification and derecognition of financial instruments. And the third part, we will discuss about hedge accounting and derivatives. So that's what we are planning for Ind AS 109. And later on, we will have Ind AS 107 on disclosure relating to financial instruments. So with that, we will have almost 5 videos to understand the financial instruments in total. We have already recorded Ind AS 32. 3 videos will be on Ind AS 109 and 1 video will be on Ind AS 107. So this makes a complete reading of financial instruments under Ind AS scenario. As we normally do, this will also have a lot of case studies to make you to understand the concepts, and we will also have a lot of worked out Excel problems picked up from various sources for enabling you to understand the concept much easier. Still, if you found any further questions to be answered or some areas I have not covered in full, you have all the liberty to put your questions, your comments, and the clarification which you are seeking for in our YouTube channel. And it is my responsibility to answer in our channel itself, so that all of you will get the larger benefit out of it. With that, I will move on to this particular slide. Just as a recap, because Ind AS 32 has been recorded long back and you may have some understanding of Ind AS 32, just to broaden the way in which the standards have been set to help you to understand the measurement as well as the recognition principles of various financial instruments, both financial assets as well as financial liabilities, let us understand that what we are going to discuss is basically Ind AS 109 today, which talks about the recognition, derecognition of financial instruments. But we are going to pick up only the recognition part today for our discussion. With respect to the classification, reclassification, measurement, and impairment of financial assets and financial liabilities, what we will do is the classification will be part of today's discussion. The reclassification and the impairment will be part of tomorrow's discussion. Derivatives and hedge accounting will be a separate session. So that's the way in which I am planning to do it. As we have already covered the definition of financial instruments, especially financial assets and financial liability, how to split them between equity and liability, and what are the various recognition principles, we have already discussed as part of our Ind AS 32 video. So in case if any of you require a clarification or recap, please go and visit our video on Ind AS 32, which will give you elaborate guidance to understand this. Maybe I will suggest you to do that for at least 15 to 20 minutes and then start with this particular video so that you will be very, very clear on what you wanted to understand on financial instruments recognition, classification and measurement principles in this video. 107 is basically the disclosures relating to financial instruments. We will cover that as a separate part of our discussion. What is Ind AS 109? Some of you might have read, maybe in old syllabus or in some other situation, our AS 30, 31 and 32. What I am trying to bring a connectivity is, what is Ind AS 109 with our AS 30, 31 and 32, which was talking about financial instruments? And of course, it was never notified, and accordingly, some of us never used it in practical sense. So for them, don't worry about it. I'm just trying to bring in a little bit of parallel, and then I will go in depth to make you to understand the concepts of Ind AS 109 in detail. Don't worry about it. Now, when we are talking about recognition and derecognition of financial assets, financial liabilities, there is no change in the principles which we have already learned under, maybe I can say, AS 30. And in fact, if you have read IAS 39, that recognition and measurement principles or derecognition principles are still retained in the same manner as per Ind AS 39 or AS 30 in Ind AS 109. We will see what is the recognition principles in detail. Don't worry about it. The second is, we have to classify the financial assets and financial liabilities into various categories. So maybe I can say that it will be fair value through P&L, or fair value through OCI, or amortized cost for financial asset, fair value through P&L and amortized cost for financial liability. How and when it has to be classified into those categories, we will discuss as part of today's discussion. Okay. And when we are talking about the classification, how it has to be measured, what is the basis of measurement, that is also will be done. Interestingly, the concept of AS 30 has been removed and a new concept called solely payment of principal and interest. That is what we say SPPI, solely payment of principal and interest. I will use SPPI throughout the standard for a simple reason. It is easier. SPPI test whether it is passed, and secondly, whether the business model approach also supports the way in which this particular classification has to be done. So we consider two elements for classification: SPPI characteristics of the instrument and what is the business model approach of the entity. Both will be taken into consideration for the purposes of our classification and for measurement. When we are talking about this two tests of SPPA and business model approach, again for financial asset, they have given a separate model, especially for equity instrument. For example, when I am talking about the classification and measurement principle, what it says is that other than equity instrument, this is the principle which you have to go with SPPA test and the business model approach. When you are talking about equity instrument, they are giving a separate guidance. As usual, what we will do is we will use certain flow chart for understanding so that you will be able to differentiate between the classification principles of other than equity instruments and equity instruments. In fact, for equity instrument, there is a new model with a lot of stringent conditions which has come in. We will understand what is the stringent conditions as well. Impairment of financial assets, there is a new model called expected credit model, which we will discuss as part of next video, where we will talk about impairment, reclassification, impairment and derecognition of financial assets. Hedge accounting, A simplified model and more practical model has been introduced as part of 109, and we will discuss this hedge accounting as a separate video, because hedge accounting and derivative is a little complex and requires a lot of worked out problems as well as case studies. So accordingly, hedge accounting, I will take it as a separate session for you to understand. Okay. So entire 109 now is going to be split into three videos. One will talk about recognition, classification and measurement. That's what we are going to discuss today. Derecognition, reclassification, impairment, we will discuss tomorrow or maybe the next video. And hedge accounting on the third video, right? You are comfortable on this. And having said that, in case, if you believe for any of the financial instrument concepts, you require any specific discussion, please post in our YouTube channel. I will consider how I can simplify and give it to you. Okay. Let's look into the structure of our discussion. Today, in this first video on Ind AS 109, as I have said, there will be another two videos on 109 itself. We will be discussing in this video what is the core principle for classifying a financial instrument, whether it's a financial asset or a financial liability, into various classifications prescribed in this standard. We will see what is a core principle. Secondly, what is the classification which we are talking about? Various classifications which are permitted for financial instruments, whether it's an asset or liability, like fair value through profit and loss account, fair value through other comprehensive income. Other comprehensive income, you have already understood the concept as part of Ind AS 1. In case if you are not clear, go back and visit our video on Ind AS 1 and you will have clarity on this. Amortized cost is another principle which has been brought in as part of Ind AS 109, and we will discuss this also as part of this video. Subsequent measurement, initial measurement we have done, and what is the subsequent measurement based on this classification, and how to account for that subsequent measurement changes into the profit and loss account or into the OCI, etc., we will see. What is the core principle for applying this particular Ind AS 109? It basically gives a core principle for classification, how you will arrive at. This is the classification which we require in respect of a financial asset or in respect of a financial liability. We have to comply with this particular conditions. All these things are arising out of the simple core principle. What it says is that two criteria has to be seen. One criteria, what is the business model of the entity for managing the financial assets and financial liability? When we are saying business model of the entity, what is the approach? What is the purpose for which they are retaining the financial asset? For example, if I'm saying that they are going to retain it till the maturity of that particular financial asset, we may have a different principle. When they are holding it for selling or trading on a regular basis, we will have a different business model. We will see the business model differently. So the business model is the first criteria, how the entity manages the business model approach in respect of financial assets and financial liability. The second, we call this as a business model test for you to understand. The second is, what is the contractual cash flow characteristics of the financial asset and financial liability? When I'm saying contractual cash flow characteristics of the financial asset and financial liability, what I have previously mentioned, whether it is solely payment of principal and interest or it has some other method, that is what we will see. For example, if I am talking about a debenture in which I have invested, what is the cash flow characteristics of the debenture? At every contracted period, the holder will get interest, and at the redemption date, he will get the principal back. So the cash flow characteristics of a normal debenture is considered to be solely payment of principal on redemption, interest at contracted rate during the contracted period, monthly, quarterly, half-yearly, yearly, whatever is the way in which it has been agreed. That is the contractual cash flow characteristics of the financial assets and liability, whether it is SPPA. What we call it as a contractual cash flow characteristics test. That is only for you to understand CCFC or BM test. Okay. Let's move on to have certain quick questions to understand the business model, and we are talking about the contractual cash flow characteristics test, right? So let us understand this. It's a long story for you to read. I will read it for you. An entity holds investment to collect their contractual cash flows. That is solely payment of principal and interest. Funding needs of entity are predictable. Maturity of its financial assets is matched to entity's estimated funding requirements. So whatever is the maturity period, I have linked it with the cash flow which is required for my running my business. The entity performs credit risk management activities and the objectives with the objective of minimizing the credit losses. So credit risk will always be there. Now when I'm investing, market like crash may be there, or maybe the entity will have some problems like that. In the past, sales have typically occurred when financial assets credit risk has increased such that the assets no longer meet the credit criteria specified in the entity's documented investment policy. In addition, infrequent sales have occurred as a result of unanticipated funding needs. So my original intention is to hold it for collecting the contractual cash flows. Because there are some problems with my sales forecast, infrequent, not regularly, occasionally there was some sales. Reports to key management personnel focuses on credit quality of the financial assets and contractual return. It is not worried about when it can be sold. Also monitors what is the fair value of the financial asset, among other information. What is the business model of the entity? Okay. Business model of the entity is to hold the investment to collect only the contractual cash flows, or different from that. If you see, it is only to collect contractual cash flows, because if you see, the risk management policy is also aligned with what is the requirement based on the maturity period. They have aligned the maturity period with the cash flow requirement. Only if unanticipated funding requirement comes in, they make a small sales. So to that extent, it is not realization of the financial asset by sale whenever it is required. It's normally infrequent. To that extent, the business model approach is to collect the contractual cash flow of the financial asset. Whatever, in this case, it is an investment on which the entity has made. Let us take one more example to understand. Here, the business model is to purchase portfolios of financial assets such as loans. Those portfolios may or may not include financial assets that are credit impaired. So what is happening in this case is like an asset management company. Their style itself is to purchase loans as a portfolio from another entity. This may have credit impaired. That means already a non-performing asset or maybe performing asset. If payment of the loans is not made on a timely basis, the entity attempts to realize the contractual cash flows through various means. The entity's objective is to collect the contractual cash flow, and the entity does not manage any of the loans in this portfolio with an objective of realizing cash flows by selling them. Objective is not to sell. In some cases, the entity enters into interest rate swap to change the interest rate on particular financial assets in a portfolio from a floating rate to fixed interest. Again, this is to ensure that the entity is not losing, because the floating rate changes, whereas entity wanted to manage the credit risk by means of fixed interest rate. Okay, what is the business model? In this case, it seems to be holding financial asset in order to collect contractual cash flow. The same analysis would apply even if the entity does not expect to receive all the cash flows. Moreover, the fact that the entity enters into derivatives to modify the cash flows does not change its business model. Because here also what they are trying to say, the portfolio does not manage the loans with the portfolio of realizing cash flows by selling them. That means it is maintaining the loans to collect the contractual cash flows. What is the contractual cash flows? What is the interest payment which is due and what is the repayments which are due at various period? Accordingly, when they have taken an interest rate swap, whether it impacts the business model, it doesn't impact the business model for a simple reason. It is only to ensure that I am not losing much when the rate of interest changes. That is the reason why they are taking some sort of interest rate swap. So business model remaining to be collecting the contractual cash flows and not to sell them. Let us take one more example. Entity B sells goods to the customers on credit, that is trade receivable. Entity B typically offers customers up to 60 days following delivery of the goods to make the payment in full. Entity B collects cash in accordance with the contractual cash flows of trade receivable and has no intention to dispose of the receivable. Evaluate the business model. You might have now understood that the business model is only to collect contractual cash flows, and accordingly, forget about the second line. The purpose of classifying will be amortized. That we will come to that little later. For the time being, the business model, even in this case, is only to collect the contractual cash flows and nothing else. It is not interested in selling. Now you understood that the business model approach, when we are talking about, we are repeatedly talking about two aspects. One, whether the entity is only collecting contractual cash flows of the particular financial asset or financial liability, or it has an intention of selling it before the date of its maturity or before the date of its redemption. This is the two aspects which we are considering, that we will see little later. One more example. Here the business model with the objective of originating loans to customers and subsequently selling those loans to in a securitization transaction. So I have loans which I will collect contractual cash flows, but I also have a principle of securitizing the particular portfolio. You might have heard what is securitization. For example, one entity is actually giving loans to housing sector, for business, for MSME. Another lending institution or financial institution wanted to have a portfolio of primary sector as per RBI guidelines. RBI guidelines, it has to go and lend. Instead of lending it, it can take the entire portfolio from another entity. That portfolio, when we are talking about, is what we call it as a securitization. The entity which is holding will convert that as a simple instrument, and that instrument will be sold to the another entity for a profit depending upon the circumstances. So here we are saying it has the originating loans to customers and subsequently selling them to a securitization vehicle. The securitization vehicle issues instruments to the investors. The originating entity controls the securitization vehicle and that consolidates. The securitization vehicle collects the contractual cash flow from loans and passes them on to the investors. In the consolidated balance sheet, loans continue to be recognized because they are not derecognized by the securitization vehicle. Evaluate the business model. What here happens is that parent company gives a loan and subsequently securitizes and give it to a special purpose vehicle. Special purpose vehicle collects the contractual cash flow and gives back to the investors. And on consolidation, there will not be any difference because it's a special purpose vehicle is showing as a separate loans to each party. Whereas in a standalone of parent, I have done a securitization transaction. Both would get eliminated. And that's what they are saying. The loans continue to be recognized because they are not derecognized by the securitization vehicle. What is the business model? In this business model, if you see in the consolidated financial statement, I am still holding the loans, right? Because I am not derecognizing it. For the consolidated financial statement, the business objective changes to contractual cash flow collection, whereas in the standalone financial statement, it is going to collect the contractual cash flows only by means of sale. So standalone is a different business objective, but on consolidated as a group, the purpose for which it is managed is nothing but to collect the cash flows. So what will happen? The classification in separate financial statement will be different. The classification in consolidated financial statement will be different. What you mean by the different classification, we will see little later. Okay. So we have seen the contractual cash flow characteristics test, right? Let us go into if the financial asset is held within the business model to hold the assets to collect contractual cash flows are achieved both by collecting the contractual cash flows and selling the financial asset. Only two models, right? One is to hold it to collect only the contractual cash flows like principal payment, interest payment, or I can also sell it whenever I wanted to sell it. So I have two business model, hold and sell, right? Entity is required to determine whether the assets contractual cash flows are solely payment of principal and interest. That is what I said. Solely payments of principal and interest is nothing but SPPI. I have to determine. SPPI means it falls into this business model where objective is only to hold the assets to collect the contractual cash flow. SPPI test will fail if I'm also having the idea of selling at any point of time. So that is what is the important test of contractual cash flow test. You have seen the business model and why the asset is held. The asset is held only to collect the contractual cash flow is the second test, or also for testing it, right? Let us understand this. It has a stated maturity date. Payment of principal and interest payment are outstanding or linked to the inflation index of the currency in which the instrument is issued. So, for example, it's a foreign bond in which I have given. So the US dollar will be the basis in which the interest and principal will happen. The inflation link is not leveraged and the principal is protected. It doesn't have a credit risk. Let us understand that. Principal will anyway will come. What is the contractual cash flow characteristics? Interest on the instrument reflects real interest. Thus, the interest amount concentration is the time value of money. Contractual cash flow reflect the return that is inconsistent with the basic lending arrangement. So when we are saying this, it seems to be not fully payment of principal and interest, because interest seems to be based on the contracted rate, whereas the inflation link is not leveraged and the principal is protected gives us some sort of different approach. Okay. Accordingly, it seems to be the contractual cash flow is not inconsistent with the basic lending arrangement. If I am doing a basic lending arrangement, what I will do? I will collect the agreed rate of interest and agreed principal. So there is some different approach or different characteristics comes in. If the different characteristics comes in, we conclude that the SPPI test is not met. That's what we normally conclude. Let's take one more example. The bond will be converted into a fixed number of equity instrument of the issuer. Analyze the cash flow characteristics. Instead of getting the repayment, it will be converted into fixed number of equity instrument. In this case, convertible bond as a whole has to be analyzed. The contractual cash flows are not payment of principal and interest because they reflect a return that is inconsistent with the basic arrangement. What will happen? I'm going to get a fixed number of equity instruments on redemption. So the equity instrument may be 100 rupees at that point of time, or 150 rupees at that point of time, or 200 rupees at the point of time. Whereas if I'm normally lending, what I will get? I will get the committed or contracted principal payment, contracted interest payment. Here the principal payment itself is something dependent on what is the fixed number of equity instrument I will buy and what would be the change in the share price. It is not consistent with the normal lending process. So to that extent, the cash flow characteristics is not solely payment of principal and interest. Let us take one more example. Here it's a perpetual instrument, but the issuer may call the instrument at any point and pay the holder the par amount plus the accrued interest due. Instrument X pays a market rate of interest, but payment of interest cannot be made unless issuer is able to remain solvent immediately afterwards. Deferred interest does not accrue additional interest. Analyze the nature of the cash flow. Here also, the contractual cash flow are not payment of solely payment of principal and interest, right? Because what happens is the issuer may be required to defer the payment of interest in case of solvency. And at the same time, when we are talking about this, he can actually, because what we normally try to understand on perpetual bond, if you recollect in Ind AS 32, we said that the principal will never be repaid, but you are entitled for regular interest, lifetime, without any particular period. That's what we have said as perpetual instrument. Ind AS 32 said that, and it has to be classified as equity, is what we have seen. In this particular scenario, at one point of time, it seems to be an equity classification, and another point of time, it seems to be an instrument, because the holder can decide the issuer can decide at what point of time he can convert that into payment of principal. So to that extent, it seems to be not connected with solely payment of principal and interest. Cash flow characteristics little bit seems to be different. Let me take one more example. Here, this company has made an investment in optionally convertible preference shares of another company at 100 rupees per share. Fair value is also 100 rupees. The holder has an option to convert this optionally convertible preference shares into equity shares into 1:1 ratio. If that option is not exercised till 9 years, then the shares will be redeemable at a premium of 20%. Analyze the cash flow characteristics of the optionally convertible preference shares. Interestingly, I will get either through conversion into equity shares or through payment of principal and interest. So it has both the possibilities, and to that extent, it is not solely payment of principal and interest. Out of this all thing which we have seen, what do you mean by solely payment of principal and interest? If you are having a loan, what is the characteristics of a loan? It will give you periodical interest and payment of principal at the maturity date. If anything other than that is put in that particular terms and condition, like by saying that you have an option to sell it, or you have the option to convert it, you have the option to link it with the market-based rate, etc., are not solely payment of principal and interest. We are simply saying, is it inconsistent with a lending term? If it is consistent with the lending term of repayment of principal and interest, is the only way in which it has been defined, the terms and conditions of the instrument defined, then it becomes a solely payment of principal and interest characteristic. Otherwise, it will be other than solely payment SPPI, other than SPPI, right? Now, why we have discussed about the business model and why we are discussing about the model relating to What is the cash flow characteristics of a particular instrument? Why we are discussing this? What is the reason why we have to look at that? This is a very simple reason. The classification criteria is dependent on that two principles. You remember that we have discussed about what is the cash flow characteristics of the instrument, and we have also seen what is the business model approach of the entity in managing the financial instrument. That's what we have seen, right? So to understand that only, we are trying to identify what do you mean by business model and what do you mean by SPPA, right? Now, based on that two characteristics, the entire financial instrument, whether it's a actually it should say it's a financial asset. In this case, we are talking about financial asset. Financial assets has to be classified into three categories. One, fair value through profit and loss account, fair value through OCI, and amortized cost. Suppose if I am saying it's a financial liability, the fair value through OCI model is not permitted. Fair value through profit and loss account and amortized cost. There are only maximum three classification. For financial liability, you are not permitted to use fair value through OCI classification. It is only fair value through P&L or amortized cost. This is a three category. How to arrive at that particular classification? How I will say that my financial asset has to be done at fair value through P&L, or it should be accounted as fair value through OCI, or it should be accounted based on amortized cost? What is the basis in which I will do? Here we will connect with what we have seen before as the criteria for classification. What is the business model approach of the entity in managing the financial assets? And it is not R, and the cash flow characteristics of the instrument. This is what we are going to see. Again, I have put this entire classification into some sort of flow chart for you to understand. Let us go into the flow chart. If you see that this flow chart should be used when you are talking about a financial asset other than equity instrument. You remember that I have talked about classification of equity instrument comes with a different model with stringent conditions that we will see a little later. As of now, other than financial asset, other than equity instruments, where I have an financial asset, how that financial asset has to be accounted for or classified. One, the first and foremost question which we are asking is a simple question of, are the assets contractual cash flows solely payment of principal and interest? What is solely payment of principal and interest? It should be consistent with a lending arrangement. If it is not consistent with the lending arrangement, it is not meeting the payment, solely payment of principal and interest. In simple terms, you keep it like that. I have made an investment in a bond. I am going to get what is a contracted interest on a periodical basis and the principal at the end of the contracted period. That is my SPPA test. If I am saying yes, this is the only characteristics of the particular asset, then I'm just taking on the reverse side. Suppose if I'm saying no, it is not meeting that particular condition alone, then we conclude that as fair value through P&L. Straight away, we will conclude that fair value through P&L. Suppose if I'm saying yes, the cash flow characteristics are only solely payment of principal and interest. The next question which we ask is that, what is the business model approach of the entity? Is the objective of the business model is to hold and collect contractual cash flow. So I'm going to hold this debenture till its maturity and will collect only the interest and the principal according to the contracted terms. I'm not doing something different. So in that case, it will go to amortized cost model. So if SPPA test is not met, straight away fair value through P&L. SPPA test met, I have to see the other condition, because two conditions we have said, both are cumulative condition. Other condition is, what is the business model approach? If the business model approach is also to manage the financial asset only to receive contracted cash flows, then it becomes an amortized cost accounting. Suppose if I say cash flow characteristics is SPPI, but the business model is not to hold till maturity to collect only the contractual cash flow. Occasionally, I will also sell it. Not what we have seen in one of the examples where unanticipated, infrequent sale. I'm saying it's not infrequent sale, regular sale. It's a significant number, amount of sale. In that case, this asset is, even though it has SPPI test passed, it fails the business model approach of collecting only the SPPA is failed because it will also sell and collect the cash flows, right? In that case, it shows that you have to classify that as fair value through OCI. Now, what we have seen, SPPA test not met, fair value through P&L. SPPA test met, contract business model is also to collect the SPPA, then we set amortized cost. SPPA test met as a cash flow characteristics of the instrument, but the business model is not only to hold and collect it, but also to sell, we set fair value through OCI. What happens? Suppose if the business model objective is neither to hold and collect contractual cash flows, neither it has the objective of both collect contractual cash flows and to sell it, what I have to do? Interestingly, this standard, fair value through P&L is a residual category. That means if none other items or classification is possible, it will automatically comes into fair value through P&L category. So if I'm saying that I'm not able to understand whether the business model is to collect only the SPPA, or I'm not able to conclude whether the business model is only to collect SPPA and the contractual cash flows, then there is something different. Automatically, as a residual category, it comes to fair value through P&L. This you have to keep it in your mind, this particular flowchart. Now, let us put this into our understanding. I have trade receivable. Where to classify trade receivable? Put the trade receivable in the first category. What is the contractual cash flow characteristics of the asset trade receivable? On the due date, my debtor will pay. So it is a solely payment of principal. Interest is not there, don't worry about it. So I'm going to collect only the asset has the characteristics of only payment of principal. If it is overdue, you may eligible for overdue interest. The cash flow characteristics has been met. The test has been met. What is the business model approach of an entity? Let us take two examples. First example, if I say I will hold the receivable till the end of the reporting period, the due date, and collect the contracted cash flow, then the business model approach is also SPPA. Because both has been satisfied, it goes to yes, amortized cost model. Suppose I said that I will take another example. I have trade receivable, cash flow characteristics is SPPA, but whenever there is a requirement, I will securitize my trade receivable and sell that. In that case, it is not to hold and collect contractual cash flow till maturity, but also to sell the asset by securitization. In that case, the same trade receivable may come as fair value through OCI category as well. Possible, but very rare circumstances. Normally, it will be amortized cost. Suppose if I am not able to sell, what is this and what is this? It will come to fair value through P&L, but a trade receivable or any receivable will normally don't come into fair value through P&L at all. Now let us take one more example. The entity has invested in a debenture. What is the cash flow characteristics of the debenture? Pays interest and pays the repayment of the principal. So first test, SPPA test has been cleared. What is the business model objective of the entity? If the entity is going to hold the instrument only to collect the principal and the interest payment and not to sell in the market at any point of time, amortized cost model or classification will be applicable. If it may also sell, then it becomes a mixed model. So the second classification of fair value through OCI will come. If I am not able to clearly say what is the business model, SPPI test alone has been met. Both condition has to be met. So as a residual category, it will come to fair value through P&L. Okay. Let us take one more example. Preference shares. Assuming that the preference shares are redeemable preference shares, put that into the flow chart. What you will get? Cash flow characteristics is to pay dividend, which is interest equivalent to that, and redemption of the face value, maybe with the premium or something like that, on the redemption date. So it passes SPPA test. When it comes to the next question, whether this redeemable preference shares will be retained till the maturity date or redemption date, and the entity will collect only the contractual cash flows, then the business model approach is also SPPA. Then in that case, both the condition is satisfied, it will be amortized cost model classification. Suppose if the redeemable preference shares has a market and the entity plans to sell that at a regular intervals, whenever there is a requirement, it sells it. In that case, it becomes a fair value through OCI. Third possibility, SPPA is the characteristics, but regularly I am buying and selling, and whatever I am holding is for trading purposes, then SPPA test is not met for business model. Hold or sell, that is also not met. What is met is something different from these two models. Regularly buying and selling, held for trading, comes to fair value through P&L. Now you will be very clear, based on the cash flow characteristics of the asset, whether it's SPPA, whether the entity is also retaining for SPPA collection, amortized cost. No, SPPA characteristics is met, but SPPA and sell will be there, fair value through OCI. If both are not there, then it is as a residual category, goes to fair value through P&L. Clear? Must be clear, right? One additional point which we have to see is that I don't want it to go through all this process. I don't want it to go to check whether it's SPPA, what is my business model. I do not want it to go. But I wanted to straight away designate that as fair value through P&L. Is it possible? The standard says at the option of the holder, it can designate any item, any financial asset as fair value through P&L irrevocably. Meaning what? Once you have classified as fair value through P&L as an option initially, it will ever be under the same category. What does it mean? If I have classified anything based on the criteria, from fair value through P&L, I can move to fair value through OCI subsequently. Reclassification is possible. Fair value through OCI to amortized cost is possible. Amortized cost to fair value through OCI is possible. Amortized cost to fair value through P&L is possible. Similarly, fair value through OCI to fair value through P&L is possible. Fair value through OCI to amortized cost is possible. If I have gone the process of classifying based on this particular business model and SPPA characteristics of the instrument, if I have opted without going through this, straight away I wanted to designate as fair value through P&L, that is a different category of financial asset within fair value to P&L. And in that case, it will never be reclassified either to fair value through OCI or amortized cost, even if the entity wanted to classify this at a later point of time. It is not possible. Now you understood, fair value through P&L as per normal process is one category. Fair value through P&L, which has been designated at the inception, is an irrevocable category. Two category could be subdivision of fair value through P&L. That's what the standard says. One can be reclassified, the other one, when you have exercised the option, can never be reclassified. Okay, we have seen other than equity instrument, what is the flow chart or what is the condition with respect to equity instrument here? Is it the equity investment is held for trading? That is, regularly I am buying, selling, I am booking short-term profit. So if that is the case, straight away it is classified as fair value through P&L. Okay. Here we are not talking about SPPI characteristics at all, because in an equity instrument, is it possible to check SPPI test? Where is solely payment of principal? Nothing. Because I have invested in entity A. A do not have any obligation to pay me at an appointed date or contracted date. So SPPA of principal is not there. What is the interest? There is no interest. It's only dividend bearing. So SPPA test straight away for not met. So normally we have seen that it should go to fair value through P&L. Because it's an equity instrument, they are saying some more additional conditions we are allowing you to check, based on which you can decide a different classification also. Accordingly, any investment in equity instrument, use this flowchart. If it is held for trading, normally to book short-term profit, regularly you are buying and selling, it is fair value through P&L. Suppose if I'm saying no, it is not held for trading, not for short-term profit booking. I may hold it for a longer period. I may sell it whenever there is a requirement which is coming. It is available for sale rather than held for trading. When it is possible, it is not held for trading. One question which the standard asks, do you wanted to apply OCI option for this? Not fair value through P&L, but fair value through OCI option you wanted to apply. If I am saying no, automatically it goes to fair value through P&L. Suppose if I am saying yes, I wanted to apply OCI option. When this option can be exercised? At the inception of the contract. That is the date on which I have invested in the equity instrument. You have to decide what is the model. If you wanted to opt for OCI model, it will be fair value through OCI model. And this model comes with some stringent conditions, which I have said. One of the condition is saying that if I have gone through the previous category where I have tested both, when I have classified an item as fair value through OCI, from fair value through OCI at the time of disposal, I will reclassify that into my profit and loss account. Whereas whatever is the balance which is staying in fair value because of fair value changes over a period of time, which I have credited to fair value through OCI, it will never be recycled to profit and loss account. Never be recycled to profit and loss account. It will be held under OCI only. Only option which is available is from the OCI balance, you can transfer to retained earnings if you want. That's the only possibility which you are having, but you cannot recycle this and take it to the profit and loss account as an income at a later point of time or expenditure at a later point of time. That is specifically prohibited if you have opted for OCI classification for equity instrument at inception, right? Not only it says the fair value changes should not be recycled to P&L. It also says that whatever is the derecognition, suppose when I am disposing the particular investment which has been classified as fair value through OCI as an option, any profit or loss arising out of that on disposal is also not permitted to be taken to the P&L account. It should also be part of OCI adjustment only. That is what stringent condition, right? No entity is interested in saying that I will retain the profit or loss also in OCI. They, at the time of disposal, they will be interested in bringing it back to P&L account. Unfortunately, that has been specifically restricted. It is not possible. Similarly, if you are testing for an impairment, normally when you are doing a fair value, impairment is automatically comes in. If you are writing down the fair value, that write down will also be retained only in the P&L and it will never be coming, sorry, only retained in the fair value OCI and never be recycled to P&L. In simple terms, whatever you have classified as fair value through OCI, all the fair value changes, all the write down to fair value changes fall in the fair value changes. Any income on disposal of the fair value of the asset will also be in fair value through OCI only. It can never be in the P&L. Having said that, one question which we are having, assuming that I am getting dividend from this equity instrument, what I have to do, whether I have to account it in OCI, here the exception is, this is an income and nothing to do with the unrealized gains or losses. So accordingly, dividend has to be accounted in the P&L. Other than dividend, all other fair value changes, impairment adjustment, or profit on sale of disposal, all those things will be kept only in OCI. From the OCI, it can directly go to the retained earnings through the balance sheet, not through the P&L. That is what the stringent condition which we are to understand about this. How you will classify a financial liability? Very simple. The financial liability will be classified into two categories, amortized cost or fair value through P&L. Fair value through OCI model is not available for financial liability. Similarly, here also, for a financial liability, at the inception, an entity can straight away designate any item as fair value through P&L. So what will happen? This determination of amortized cost and fair value through P&L will also go with the same principle. What is the business model approach and what is the cash flow characteristics of the particular liability? That will determine how you will classify it as fair value through P&L or amortized cost. For example, if I have taken a loan. Loan, what is the characteristics of that particular loan? I have to pay contracted interest on a regular basis, periodically, whatever is agreed. And then I have to pay the principal repayment as agreed. That is what the contractual cash flow of the financial liability. What is the business model? When I took a loan, I will normally pay the interest and principal as contracted. The business model is also solely hold it and settle the contracted cash flow. So accordingly, it will become part of my amortized cost model. If it is not amortized cost model, SPPA test is not met, or business model is not to pay SPPA, then automatically it comes to fair value through P&L. Fair value through OCI is not available. Okay. Now, let us take some example. Here is the company which has purchased raw material from a vendor at a fixed price of 1,000 per metric ton. The payment terms provides 45 days credit period, after which an interest of 18% per annum shall be charged. How the creditors to be classified in the books of the company? What is the cash flow characteristics? I have to pay on the due date, 45 days. If I'm not paying within 45 days, I'm supposed to pay along with interest. So SPPA characteristics. What is my business model? When I purchase, I will pay, right? So to that extent, it has to be carried at amortized cost, right? Because the transactions when it is happening, this second bullet, we will, for the time being, we will forget about it. This is nothing but what is the initial recognition? I will come to that little later. As of now, it meets the SPPA characteristics as well as the business model is also SPPA. So it goes to amortized cost. Let us take one more example. It purchases a portfolio of fixed rate assets that will be financed by fixed rate debentures. Okay, debenture is my liability. Both financial assets and financial liabilities are subject to the same interest rate risk that gives rise to opposite charges, changes in fair value that tend to offset each other. So what happens when I have purchased an asset, I have financed it by debentures. So one side I have 10% debenture, other side I have invested in 10% asset. So I do not have any debit or credit, or it is nullified. There is no impact for me. In that case, how you will classify this particular debenture? So it will be fair value through P&L because your business model is not for SPPA. Your business model is to ensure that the fair value changes will adjust with each other, and accordingly SPPA test fails, or maybe even if I say SPPA test is failed, but the business model is not to collect the contractual cash flows. So to that extent, both of them has to be classified as fair value through P&L. Both asset as well as the liability will be treated as part of fair value through P&L. We said fair value through P&L, fair value through OCA. What do you mean by fair value through P&L? Initially, I will recognize at fair value. Subsequently, I remeasure at fair value. The fair value changes between the two periods. If it is accounted in the profit and loss account, that is called fair value through P&L. If the fair value changes are routed through OCI, it is called fair value through OCI. That's a two classification. The third one, we said amortized cost. Amortized cost normally happens when both the SPPA test is also met and the cash flow character, business model is also to collect SPPA. We said it is an amortized cost. How to consider amortized cost for a financial asset? How it is defined? It simply said amortized cost is equivalent to what is the cash you have paid for making that investment, or what is the amount you have paid, and minus the principal repayment which you have collected, plus or minus any unamortized premium or discount, minus credit risk related impairment which you have taken. So if you look into that, it is not the carrying amount. Carrying amount as defined in Ind AS 16 or in any other framework, it says the cost of acquisition minus accumulated depreciation minus accumulated impairment. There is no question of depreciation which is coming in, right? So sometimes people will say amortized cost is nothing but carrying amount at cost, historical cost. It is not historical cost. It amortized cost is considering what is the various repayments which you have made and making an adjustment towards the unamortized premiums and discounts, and of course tested for impairment. And accordingly, if you are thinking that amortized cost is equivalent to historical cost accounting, no, it is a totally a different concept. What it says is, to account for this amortized cost, you have to use effective interest rate method. And effective interest rate method is nothing but the rate at which exactly the inflows and outflows are discounted over the maturity period. What does it mean? I have given a cash, there is an outflow, and I'm getting principal repayments and interest repayment, which is an inflow. But these are happening at different time period. So during the time period, when I am discounting it time for time value of money, net present value, what is the rate at which it will exactly discount? I have to identify that effective interest rate. Using that, the amortized cost has to be worked out. It says that you cannot use a straight line method of saying, whatever is the amortized cost, I will use a straight rate of whatever contracted. No, it is not possible. Let us understand this by means of a small worked out problem. Then you will be appreciate what is amortized cost, because majority of the problems are relating to amortized cost in examination. Let me just have a look on this. Here, I have given a rent-free deposit, no loan, but I have given a rent-free deposit. What is the cash flow characteristics of a rent-free deposit? I have given today, at the end of my lease period, I will get the money back. So it is solely payment of principal. There is no question of interest because it's interest-free. So SPPA test has been passed. What is the business model of the entity, going by the flowchart which we have seen for other than equity instrument? What is the cash flow business model of the entity? Till such time the lease is outstanding, it will retain that in the same level, and on vacation of the lease or termination of the lease, it will get back. So that is also to collect only the contractual cash flow. SPPA test is also matched with the business model. According to that, if both the conditions are satisfied, we said it should be at amortized cost. Now, rental deposit is also meeting the both the test. Now, only problem is, I do not have an interest rate. So whenever any asset or liability which is designated at a rate lower than the market rate or free, zero interest, or market rate is 10%, you are going to get only 2%. Whenever it is less than the market rate, you have to necessarily adjust them for net present value. That net present value method, when you are applying, this will give you what is the closing amortized cost at every reporting period. That's what we are going to do in this particular case. Once you have understood this, same principle you will apply for everything. Here I am talking about 0% interest. And accordingly, I am trying to identify what is the discounting rate. Here we are talking about market rate for a similar deposit is 12%. So we are using 12% discounting rate instead of 10%. What it says, it is for 5-year period. Okay. SPPA test met for the cash flow characteristics. SPPA test met also for the business model. So it should be amortized cost. Now, 10 lakh I have given today and I will get after 5 years. Naturally, there will be a time value of money. So I have to arrive at what should be the implicit interest by using a discounting rate. That discounting rate is equivalent to the market rate to identify. So here it's given as 12%. So normally in problems, you will know what is the discounting rate which you have to apply. In practical scenario, we normally look for what is the rate at which the entity can, lessor can borrow from the market. That's what here we are saying, market rate for the deposit. Now, security deposit is 10 lakhs, 5 years is a lease period, discounting rate is 12%. So present value factor at 12% for 5 years, at the end of the 5 years is 0.56743. At the beginning will be 5.67, because I have worked out this number, right? So if you are arriving at that 10 lakhs, if you wanted to have it after 5 years, you require to invest only 5.67 lakhs today based on your net present value. So when we are talking about that net present value, that should be taken as the rental deposit on day one. What should happen for the balance amount? The balance amount is considered as your loss due to net present value or time value of money. And that is considered as your prepaid lease expenses on day one. Okay, now rental deposit is not 10 lakhs, it is only 5.67 lakhs. After the end of the fifth year, what I will happen, what I will get? I will get 10 lakhs, not 5.67 lakhs. So the 5.67 lakhs has to increase and come back to 10 lakhs. How I will do? If I have given a deposit to an outsider, he will pay me 12% interest. So 5.67 lakhs. At 12%, I will recognize interest income, credit interest income, debit security deposit because it is accruing on that, right? So said, if I'm charging 12% interest year on year, automatically what will happen is I will get the balance at 10 lakh rupees at the end of the period. That will automatically come back. But what happens to the prepaid lease expenses? It remains as an asset in the balance sheet. Is it correct? So the prepaid lease expenses is nothing but my loss because I am not getting any interest out of it. So this loss has to be accounted on a straight line basis throughout the 5 years by debiting rental expenses because it's relating to rental deposit, debiting rental expenses and crediting prepaid lease expenses. So prepaid lease expenses over a period of time will become zero at the end of the maturity period. That is what we are trying to do. So security deposit each period, year one is the interest based on your working. 10% interest on 12% interest on 5.67 lakhs is 68,091 and you are taking that as an interest income. Lease expenses debited or rental expenses debited with a corresponding credit. 866515 is nothing but 4.32 divided by 5 on a straight line basis. Okay. At the end of the period, what will happen? Security deposit. Last period, the last entry will be security deposit account debtor to interest income. That's for the last year. Lease will also be straight line only. It is not going to change. That will, the security deposit will now become 10 lakhs. The prepaid lease expenses will be zero. And we are going to collect it back. So bank account debit, security deposit credit. This is the amortized cost. Whenever the rate of interest is below the market rate. Here 0%, so we have taken straight away 12%. Suppose if it is 4%, what I have to do? Market rate is 12%. 4% is what I am collecting. So differential amount is 8%. Use 8% for doing the discounting and account for it. That's a simple accounting principle for amortized cost accounting. What is the amortized cost for a financial liability? Same logic, only difference is impairment will not be there. Okay, so let me work out. Let me take up some example for you to understand this financial liability, because I have seen a lot of questions are coming from this amortized cost accounting as well. In this particular situation, what we are trying to see is that the entity has taken a loan of 10,000. It starts on 2011 and ends on 2013. And the repayment of the loan starts only from 30th September. That means they have 6 months moratorium. Installment payment, that is, it's being paid every half year, or yeah, it is 2,500. Interest rate is 12%. Okay. That's the repayment starts half yearly. Repayment should be there, 2,500. Interest is 12% and interest charge is quarterly. So interest is quarterly, principal repayment is half yearly. So you have to arrive at what is the interest for each of the period, that is an outflow. And what is the amount you are actually paying is an outflow, right? 12% on 10,000 rupees for the outstanding amount. 10,000 rupees is the outstanding amount for the up to September 2011. After that, you are paying 2,500. It becomes 7,500, on which you are supposed to charge what is the quarterly interest. The quarterly interest is an outflow. Repayment of principal of 2,500 starting from September 2011 is another outflow. And your inflow is 10,000 rupees. And of course, it also says there is an upfront fee of 500 rupees. That means inflow is 10,000 minus 500. That is actually the inflow which has happened. So that 9,500 should be repaid by means of 2,500 rupees every half year to meet 10,000 rupees along with the interest which it is due, right? Interest is payable on 10,000 rupees, not on 9,500 rupees. So in this situation, what is the exact rate which I have to use for discounting the inflows and outflows has to be first determined. That will be used for effective interest rate calculation as well as discounting for this particular item. And whatever I am calculating as an interest as per effective interest will be debited to P&L. What I am actually paying based on the contracted rate will be considered as a repayment of the interest portion. There may be some additional portion which is not repaid because it is not contracted as such, but it will get automatically reversed at a later point of time where I'm still paying as per my effective interest rate model, whereas the actual amount due as per this will be lower than that model. Could be a possibility, right? Let us see that. So the loan has been taken at what is actually I have taken as an inflow is 9,500 rupees. Oh God. Okay. This yesterday night I was actually testing it. You can simply make a small change, otherwise I have to make the entire change. This upfront fee is 500 rupees, what I have taken in the example. Now I have retested that with 432 rupees. Just use 432 rupees as your processing fee. Correct your calculation at 432, then it will be all right. because it's 432, the amount of inflow will be 9568. Because I wanted to teach you how you can simply arrive at the IRR. For that purpose, I was making some changes in the night, and I think that I have missed it to update that particular to the original position. So it should be 432. This will be 9568. All other things will remain the same. Now, on day one, 10,000 rupees, which I am having, and out of which upfront fee I have paid 432, actual inflow came only 9568. Every quarter I will pay interest on the outstanding balance on the face value, which is 10,000 rupees, on which I pay 12% interest, which is coming to, for 90 days, it comes to say 300 rupees is the outflow. Forget about that last two column, I will explain it later. First, we are trying to arrive at what is the effective interest rate method which we wanted to apply for accounting for the interest according to amortized cost principle of Ind AS 109. The last two columns I will come back later. Just I am plotting the actual inflows and outflows according to the terms of the loan. Loan is 10,000, upfront fee is 432, actual inflow on day one is 9568. But I have quarterly commitment to pay interest on the outstanding balance, not on after reducing 432, on 10,000 rupees at 12% for 3 months is what I'm supposed to pay, which is an outflow. And half yearly, I have to repay the principal. In this half year when I'm making, there is a quarterly interest payment also which comes in. So that also I'm plotting as the repayment, outflow. Similarly, because I have repaid the loan, 10,000 minus 2,500, it's 7,500 now, on which 92 days interest, what is the number? So it's a 225. Again, next half year, I'm making the repayment. Finally, 4 repayments are made, the related interest. I have captured all these things. What we are trying to say, that in case, if you are talking about the IRR or the effective interest rate method, the inflows and outflows should be discounted to zero at the end of the period. That's what this column is to be zero. To arrive at that as a zero, if I am charging interest at 300 rupees, it will never be. So accordingly, I have to charge interest at a higher rate. To arrive at that higher rate, even though my contracted rate is 12%, actual IRR, to consider this 432 along with the balance impact on my repayment over a period of time, I have to arrive at what is the IRR. Let me stop for a moment. You may ask, sir, why we are talking about that 432 rupees as reduction in this? It is a bank charges. I will debit to bank charges straight away in the first year. Stop for a moment. Ind AS says, any transaction cost to obtain a loan should be reduced from that loan. And you have to account your interest based on effective interest rate method. In simple terms, what it tried to say is that this 432 should not be the charge to P&L on the first date on which the loan has been taken, but should be amortized over the loan repayment period, because it's a servicing of loan for the entire period. So recognize it. How that 432 will come based on your effective interest rate method. Effective interest rate method is nothing but your IRR. If you are properly plotting your inflows and outflows, I have plotted the inflow of 9568 and various outflows which over a period of time I have done, and I have arrived at the IRR using the formula given in Excel. Okay, this is one method in which I have arrived at. Another method is normally being done. If you see, what I was actually trying to find out is that your rate is 12% and your processing fee on your principal comes to 4.32%. So accordingly, I am taking maximum range is 12% plus 4.32%. Minimum range is 1% less than that, because trial and error you have to find out, right? Because taking too many items of trial and error, you can also go by this method. What is the processing fee upon your principal? 432 divided by 10,000 into percentage comes to 4.32%. I am adding it to the contracted rate to arrive at the maximum range, because including this is the total amount I am going to pay. So maximum range will be 16.32. Minimum range, I wanted to find out within which it falls. No, I am taking 1% less than that. That is 15.32. This is what I was saying that yesterday. I was trying to find out how I can teach you. So once it has been done, you are trying to find out what is the price. Actually, it is again wrong. It is not 16%. It is actually 16.32%. Again, the correction which I have not made. It is 16.32%. It is 15.32%. If it is 16%, then it will be 4%, but it's 4.08, nothing but 0.32 is also factored. Change this in your working note as 16.32 and 15.32. At 16.32, 4.08 is my quarterly number, which I am working out, which comes to 15. I have arrived at what is the discounted cash flow using that discounting rate for my inflows and outflows. That comes to 9,529. Similarly, what I am doing for 15.32, what is the cash outflow between 9,529 and 9,635? Actually, my outflow will fall. So you know pretty well how to do that. You know that it should be the amount which you are supposed to pay, that is 9,568 minus of the variance between these two numbers, 9,529 and 9,635, which is given in the formula, into the percentage. That is the percentage or the effective interest rate which you can use it for your discounting. This 15.9521 is nothing but, if you see that, 15.9502, approximately it gives you the same result. Why it is not exactly 15.9521 is only one reason. I have not factored the interest payment on the due date in arrears or on the due date. So if I have factored that percentage also, if I have done that percentage also here, there could be a little bit of addition which will be coming in that will reduce that rate to 15.95. This is one method which you can use. But majority of the people are using a different method of mostly it is normally given in part of your problem itself. If it is not in the problem, use the IRR in your calculator and arrive at how you have to do it. That IRR rate will be used for accounting your amortized cost model. So two things which you are supposed to make the change. This will be 432. And this 9,500 is 9,568. And of course, this is what is given in the problem. Forget about that. This is what I have tried. It is 16.32 and 15.32. Only these three corrections which you have to do in your thing. So on that basis, you will be able to do the amortized cost accounting. Right? Now, what is the amortized cost accounting? I said, you have to calculate the interest based on the effective interest rate. On day one, there is no interest. But at the first quarter, my contracted rate is 12%, which is 300. But actual IRR, which I am talking about, is basically 15.95%. So on 15.95%, what is the interest payable for 90 days is 376. That should be passed as debit interest expenses, credit your loan. And on that loan, what you have actually repaid? 300 rupees. So 9,568 plus 376 minus 300 will give you 9,644. Okay. That is what you will show that as an amortized cost of the loan at the end of first quarter. Second quarter, 9,644 plus 388 minus 300 minus 2,500. It is what we have said, na? Cash paid minus principal repayment plus or minus premium or discount. Premium or discount is happening between 388 and 300 because of time value of money. So 9,644 plus 388 minus 300 in actual payment minus 2,500 actual repayment of principal give you 7,232. So 7,232 is your amortized cost for period 2, right? This is the same method you will follow. This is what we call it as an amortized cost accounting. Okay. Now, what is your initial recognition? The initial recognition says that all financial instruments ought to be accounted at fair value at the time of inception. That means on the date of transaction, you are supposed to consider that at fair value. When I'm saying fair value, I'm also using generally recognized at fair value. Is there any exception? Very rare circumstances, you are allowed to use it a cost model for equity instrument where you are saying that I am not able to determine fair value because the equity investments has been made in a unlisted company where I do not have any information. Okay, rare of the rare circumstances where it is permitted. Otherwise, always fair value at inception. When I'm saying fair value at inception, there could be a possibility that the fair value will be equivalent to the transaction price, because when I'm entering into a transaction for purchase, normally it is a price at which a third party is ready to sell, right? That is a market participant's approach. And to that extent, it is equivalent to my fair value. It is actually fair value is determined as per Ind AS 113 fair value measurement. We will discuss that at a later point of time. Transaction price is considered to be equivalent to market price. But there are some exception given in Ind AS 113 where it says transaction price may not be equivalent to fair value. In that case, you have to arrive at what is the day one profit or day one loss, and that should be accounted for as part of that. Okay. This is a general principle for initial recognition. Fair value at the initial measurement is nothing but if the instrument is at market terms, take the transaction price. If it is off market, that is no active market is available, then determine fair value based on fair value measurement in Ind AS 113. It may be level one input where you have observable market prices, or it may be, before I go to the second level, suppose transaction price minus fair value, if there is a difference, that's what I say, day one profit or loss should be taken to the profit and loss account. Suppose if it is not level one, any other basis, difference between the fair value and the transaction will be recognized as an asset in case if it is part of an asset, or it will be charged to the profit and loss account. Suppose if I'm saying it is relating to a qualifying asset and I'm taking a loan, that may be part of my borrowing cost also. So to that extent, it may be added to the cost of the asset as well, or otherwise it normally charged to P&L account, right? But it is amortized over a period of time. Fair value through P&L, immediately it goes. Fair value through OCI or amortized cost, it is amortized over a period of time. Okay. What is my checkpoint? Here, Containers Limited provides containers for use by customers for multiple purposes. Containers are returnable after 3 years. In addition to the monthly charge, there is a security deposit which I have collected. That means it's a liability for me, 10,000 per container. Such deposits are refundable, do not carry any interest, like a rental deposit which I have paid. It's a security deposit I have received. So instead of asset, it's a liability. Analyze the fair value upon initial recognition in books of customers leasing containers. Market rate of interest is 7% per annum. So what I am normally trying to do, what I have paid is 10,000, but the market value or the fair value of that using 7% discounting rate, the present value is only 8,163. That is, for 3 years, it comes to 8,163. So day one amount is 1,837. If it is fair value through P&L, what I have said, it should be charged to P&L straight away, because this is under amortized cost, because my contractual obligation is to settle the principal. The cash flow characteristics is also to settle the principal at the appointed date. So to that extent, it goes for amortized cost. In amortized cost, I cannot take the entire 1,837 as my debit to P&L. It has to be taken as prepaid interest and amortized over the 3 year period using effective interest rate method. Here we have arrived at 7% as the effective interest rate method. So with that, we will actually work out and amortize this 1,837 also, like what we have seen in rental deposit case. That's what you say. If fair valuation is determined using level one inputs, then the difference taken to P&L. Otherwise, it is actually taken to asset or liability, and it is treated as a prepaid lease rent in case if it is a lease deposit. Here, it is a security deposit. So I am falling as a lessor. So I will consider that as a prepaid lease rent and amortize over a period of time on a straight line basis. What is the transaction cost? I have talked about that 10,000 rupees loan taken, 430 rupees of processing fee. And I said it should be reduced from the cost of the loan, reduced from the loan value. That is because of this particular principle. The principle says any incremental cost directly attributable to acquisition, issue, or disposal of financial asset and financial liability should be added to the financial asset if it is an asset. Transaction cost should be added to the financial asset or to financial liability. It should be deducted from the debt. Only exception is fair value through P&L, because you have already done a fair valuation and only the fair value changes will go to the P&L account. Taking this as an amortization over a period of time will be incorrect situation. So if it is fair value through P&L, it will be straight away debited to P&L on day one. In all other cases, it will be added to the asset and or deducted from the liability. But because it is deducted from the liability, it impacts my contracted rate with the effective interest rate method. That's what we have seen. 432 rupees of processing fee I have given. Actually, I have taken on 10,000 rupees of loan. Actual inflow comes to 9,568. To that extent, I'm adjusting that particular number. Okay. That is what we are saying. Suppose if it is incurred for disposal of an asset, is it a transaction cost? No, because transaction cost is directly attributable cost of acquiring that asset. Like Ind AS 16, what we have done, property plan equipment. Any directly attributable cost, I am adding to the cost of the asset. Same logic they have brought in here. But at the same time, when I'm selling a property plan equipment, Ind AS 16 says that it's a selling cost, any brokerage which you are paying. That doesn't mean that it should be added in the measurement of amortized cost. Similarly, in financial asset also, if it is for disposal of the financial asset, that will not be added or deducted in the respective financial asset or financial liability. It is considered as an expenditure in the period in which the disposal actually happens. Let us take an example. Here we have a purchase commission of 2 rupees and 100 rupees is the cost of that original asset. So initially entity has to recognize as 102 because transaction cost should be added. The reporting period ends 1 year later, sorry, 1 day later, when the quoted market price is only 100. So fair value through P&L, if I apply, this 2 rupees has to go to the P&L on the reporting date. If the asset were sold, a commission of 3 should be paid. Whether I have to adjust that 3 rupees? No, it is actually a transaction cost for disposal, so I should not account for it. What I have to do on the date, I have to recognize the asset at 100 and recognize the loss on 2 rupees in other comprehensive income because it's fair valued through, it is fair valued. I'm assuming that it's a fair value because we are talking about quoted market price, right? So it's a fair value. Because of that, we are considering that as part of loss in the P&L. P&L may be P&L or other comprehensive income. So I'm taking that. Suppose if it is fair value through other comprehensive income. Sorry, again, there is an error. This 2 rupees, if it is fair value through P&L, it will go to my comprehensive income, not other comprehensive income. It will go to P&L. Suppose if I'm fair valuing through OCI, then I will amortize this 2 rupees over the repayment period. But in the example, just 1 day, there is no question of effective interest rate method. In both the scenarios, it will be debited. One, in the first case, it will be debited to, if it is fair value through P&L, it will be debited to fair value through P&L. Sorry, if it is fair value through P&L. Suppose if it is fair value through OCI, that 2 rupees will be debited to OCI. In this case, there is no effective interest rate method because the settlement happens within 1 day. The 3 rupees is a transaction cost. Only on disposal, it will be accounted as an expenditure. What is the subsequent measurement of financial assets and financial liabilities and how it has to be measured? We have said initial measurement is always at fair value, right? And day one profit or loss should be taken to the profit and loss account or to be amortized over a period of time. If it is fair value through P&L, you take it to P&L. If it is fair value through OCA or amortized cost, take it over and amortize using effective interest rate method. That's what we have seen. Initially, when we have classified as fair value through P&L, fair value through OCA, amortized cost for asset, fair value through P&L and amortized cost for liability. Subsequently, when I am measuring, what I am supposed to do? Suppose if it is asset or liability which are classified as amortized cost, I have to measure the amortized cost using the effective interest rate method, and the adjustment will be based on that effective interest rate method. That's what we have seen. Even though the contracted interest is only 300, we have debited somewhere more than that, 389 or something like that, we have debited. Using the effective interest rate method, I have to recognize the accrual in the expenditure, and related adjustment will be on the liability side. Similarly for asset also. So I have to measure them using amortized cost model. If it is debt instrument classified as fair value through OCA, other than equity, right? If it is a debt instrument which has been classified as fair value through OCA, maybe I can say not necessarily debt instrument, any financial asset which is classified as OCA, I will fair value at every reporting period, but the fair value changes will be taken to OCA. That is what fair value through OCA means. If it is an equity instrument classified as fair value through OCA, here also I will do a fair valuation. I will take the fair value changes to OCA, but that balance in OCA will never be reclassified even on disposal. Whereas in the previous case, if I held it at OCA, on disposal, whatever amount which is there in OCA will be recycled to the profit and loss account. Whereas here, that is not permitted. That's the only difference between these two equity instrument, other than equity instrument, which are fair valued through OCA. If it is assets or liabilities which are fair valued through P&L, I will do the fair value changes, and the fair value changes will go to P&L account. Okay. Let us see the subsequent measurement at fair value. Interest and dividend will be immediately recognized in the profit and loss account. Gains and losses, if it is fair value through P&L, I have to see if it is realized or unrealized gains and losses. Both of them will be taken to profit and loss account because my model is fair value through P&L. Okay. Suppose if I am saying it is fair value through OCA, but it is relating to equity instrument, realized and unrealized gains and losses will be recognized in OCA, will never be recycled to the P&L account. That's what we have said. Suppose if I am saying it is fair value through OCA other than equity instrument, anything other than equity instrument, realized portion will be recognized in P&L account, unrealized portion will be recognized in OCA. That's what we are saying. Realized portion means on realization, recycled to P&L account. Here, no such P&L account, everything will be retained only in OCA. You understand this particular accounting principle. If it is fair valued instrument, if it's an amortized cost, then we will use amortized cost for accounting our adjustment in P&L. In case of fair valued, interest and dividend should go to P&L straight away. If it is gains and losses on restatement, that's a fair value changes. If it is fair value through P&L, realized and unrealized will go to P&L because fair value changes by designation is going to P&L. If it is fair value through OCI equity instrument, realized will go as well as unrealized will go to OCI. If it is other than equity instrument, but you have opted for fair value through OCI model, realized will go to P&L, unrealized will go to OCI. Let me take some example for you to understand this particular concept. Maybe I felt that an Excel working will be easier for you to understand. Here I am talking about assets recognized at fair value through P&L. Cost of investment is 10,000, which has been made on 15th March. transaction cost is 500 and 31st March equity share has a fair value of 11,200. Market rate for 10% loan is 10 year loan is 10%. Since I said it's fair value through OCI, it is an investment in equity shares. Hence, I cannot have any contractual SPPI test will not apply. Because SPPI test will not apply, I have to consider that as fair value through P&L. When I'm talking about fair value through P&L, the transaction cost is not to be amortized. It should be charged to P&L account. The 10,000 rupees becomes 11,200 rupees. So what I have to do is a simple journal entry. At the time of acquisition, investment 10,000, transaction cost expenditure 10,000, and 10,500 is gone. And in the profit and loss account, whatever transaction cost is moved to the profit and loss account as an expenditure. At the reporting period, that's a subsequent measurement which we are talking about, it becomes how much? From 10,000, it has gone to 11,200. So 1,200 is my fair value changes, which is a gain which I credit to fair value gain on financial instrument, debit my investment. That is the investment value goes up. From that account, I'm transferring to the P&L account to close that particular account. It's taken to the P&L account. In simple terms, because in this case, it's an equity instrument, only fair value through P&L will be applicable. First, to recollect your classification from principle. Cash flow characteristics should be solely payment of principal and interest, that is SPPI. Business model also SPPI. If both are fails, it can only go to fair value through P&L. Anyone fails also, you have to see the second condition, whether it is also for buying and selling. If you say buying and selling, hold and sell, then you say fair value through OCI. In an equity instrument, there is no question of that, because the SPPI test itself is not fulfilled. It goes straight away to your fair value through P&L category classification. So on fair value through P&L, what is the initial recognition which I have to do? I have to do on the fair value. The purchase price is equivalent to the fair value because it's a quoted market price which they are talking about. So I am straight away taking that. Transaction cost is 500 rupees. The transaction cost in respect of fair value through P&L instrument has to be straight away accounted in P&L account. That's what we have seen as an exception. In all other cases, it will be added or deducted to the asset or liability. Accordingly, nothing to do on this for making some adjustment on fair value. Fair value at the end of the reporting period becomes subsequent measurement. The difference is 1,200. That 1,200 will be taken to P&L because it is fair value through P&L. The market rate is not having any relevance. Suppose if I'm saying this is not an equity instrument, but it's a debenture and the entity wants to retain that till the maturity period, what will happen? The fair value we will ignore. The 10,000 rupees minus the 10,000 rupees plus the 500 rupees because it's an asset, it will be added 10,500 rupees. But what I will get at the end of the period is only 10,000 rupees plus whatever interest which is part of it. I will find out whether 10% will exactly discount or I have to use an effective interest rate method. On that basis, this 500 rupees will be amortized over the period of whatever is the holding period. In this case, maybe it's a 10-year period, right? Suppose if it is fair value through OCI, what I will do? This 1,200 rupees will be going to OCI. 500 rupees will be added to the asset and will be amortized over the period of maturity. So that is what we will do if it is fair value through OCI. So subsequent measurement is depending upon what is the classification you have done. That is an important aspect which we are supposed to have. I think we have one more Excel working, which I will show you that also for you to understand. Here what happens is it is fair value through OCI, 19% investment in equity instrument, they have opted for it. Cost of investment is 4,90,000, transaction cost is 10,000. Fair value at the end of the period is 45. Here we are taking fair value through OCI model for an equity instrument. They have exercised an irrevocable option of designating this as fair value through OCI. That means it will never be recycled to P&L. Let us understand this. What happens first day? Investment which I have made is 5 lakh rupees. That is inclusive of my transaction cost, because we said transaction cost should also be included if it is fair value through OCI or amortized cost. Only for fair value through P&L, it should be debited straight away to P&L account. Here it is added to the fair value asset value, which is 5 lakh. Then on June, when I am doing it, it comes to 45 rupees fair value into 10,000 is nothing but 4.5 lakhs. That means there is a loss of 50,000, which I am recognizing in OCI, not taking it in this. So automatically, since it is added to the cost of this transaction cost has been added to that, the 50,000, the moment the fall happens, charged to P&L account, right? Next period when it is goes up, it will be adjusted. So till the end of the period, this adjustment is automatically taken care when we are talking about this 10,000 rupees of transaction cost, which is relating to OCI. Suppose if it is amortized cost, whatever we have done with respect to the financial asset rental deposit has to be accounted. One side you will take the interest income, and another side you will take the prepaid interest, and you will account for that as your adjustment. Now you are very clear on what to do with the fair value changes. If it is fair value through P&L, both realized and unrealized goes to the P&L. If it is fair value through OCI, which is an equity instrument, it retains in OCI. That's what we have seen in the first illustrated example. And if it is other than equity instrument where you have opted for it, sorry, in the second example, we have took that option. So we are retaining in OCI. Other than equity instrument in the first option, realized portion has gone to P&L and unrealized portion remains at OCI, right? So clear on this. Now, with that, we have concluded the first part of financial instrument standard on especially 109 on what is the criteria for deciding the classification, what is the two conditions which are required or the core principle which is required, and based on the two principle, how we have to classify a financial asset other than equity instrument into fair value through P&L, fair value through OCI, amortized cost. If it is a financial liability, fair value through P&L or amortized cost. If it is an equity instrument, there is a special condition which says that you can opt for irrevocable option of fair value through OCI. In that case, subsequent fair value changes also retained in OCI, which we have seen. So the three classification which we have seen, and we have said that the transaction cost should be added or deducted depending upon whether it's a financial asset or financial liability. Only exception which we have said was if it is fair value through P&L, it will be straight away accounted in the P&L on the date of acquisition. And we have also seen that the financial assets and financial liability should always be accounted at their fair value on the date of inception. And in case if the transaction price is different from the fair value, day one profit or day one loss should be taken to our P&L account or OCI, depending upon what is the classification which we have identified. After that, we have seen subsequent measurement based on the classification. Fair value is again calculated. If it is fair value through P&L, I will take it to P&L. If it is fair value through OCI, the fair value changes will be taken to OCI. If it is fair value through OCI with respect to equity instrument, it will always be maintained even at the time of disposal in OCI. Only option available is from OCI, you can change it to retained earnings through the balance sheet route and not through P&L. Suppose if it is fair value through OCI other than equity instrument, we have said it will be recycled to the P&L on disposal. And the third category, we said amortized cost model. Amortized cost model, we will work out based on effective interest rate, which we will find out based on whether the rate of interest is equivalent to the market rate or it is not equivalent to the market rate. If it is below the market rate, we will make an adjustment. Similarly, wherever there is a transaction cost involved, amortized cost will also undergo a change from contracted rate to effective interest rate method. Using the effective interest rate method, you have to recognize your interest, debit, credit the liability, and the liability will go on accumulating with actual repayments over the contracted period. Exactly, it will discount it to zero at the maturity period. That's what amortized cost accounting, subsequent measurement, which we have seen. With that, I will stop the first part of our Ind AS 109 discussion, and I will come back with this second part where we will talk about reclassification, impairment, derecognition. Okay, so if you are having any questions on this particular first part of Ind AS 109, you can post your questions as part of our YouTube channel. I will surely answer your questions. And please be careful about making the corrections which I have mentioned, which crept in because I was testing certain things and sometimes I was missing the typo error. Make the changes when you are reading, otherwise you may have a different answer. With that, I take leave from this particular session. Goodbye.